brothers and sisters, let us gather this morning to celebrate and worship the one true God.
Let us thank God for life and love on this planet we call home, mindful of our greater home with Christ.
May we notice the gifts God provides for us each and every day.
Let us be thankful for the opportunities God provides throughout our lives.
God, we give you praise and thanks for your presence in this short time we walk this earth.
Most of all, God, we thank you for loving us no matter what. Amen.
Amen indeed. And now, please join in singing two verses of Count Your Blessings.
When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
You may be seated. At this time, before we speak with God in prayer, would you join me in a moment of silence as we strive to listen to God? Let us pray. We now enter a time of shared prayer. If you have an item of concern, celebration, or praise, we invite you to lift it before God, either out loud or silently. Lord, knowing you hear and respond, we come before you now in prayer.
God, I would ask you to be with Joyce Starks as she prepares to move her household to Portage tomorrow, and help us do that move well with as little trauma to her as possible.
Lord, we come to you with joy and thanksgiving for the gifts we enjoy every day. We are grateful for friends, for family, health, and home, fresh water and food, the warmth of summer and its products of growth. And yet, in the midst of all this, we so quickly shift our attention to the uncertainties of life. You call us to trust in you, Lord. Help us when we don't trust you enough. We pray for those who are lonely, depressed, facing financial struggles, and those with failing health We pray for broken relationships and for homes where violence and the threat of violence have become normal. Thank you for loving us, for forgiving us, and for showing us how to just be kind. Please extend your healing wholeness throughout humanity. We pray all this in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
First reading is from John, chapter 13, verses 3 through 7. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around them. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand."
Our next reading is from Esther, chapter 4, verses 11 through 14. Queen Esther responded, "All the king's officials and the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king has but one law, that they be put to death, unless the king extends the gold scepter to them and spares their lives. But 30 days have passed since I was called to go to the king." When Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back his answer, "Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this." May God bless the reading and understanding of this word. Two things from our scripture readings that I'd like to highlight. From John, I won't always realize what God is doing. And from Esther, it just might be that what I'm going through today will impact a much bigger story. That's what I heard in these two readings. And I'm going to share with you a few pieces of my own timeline, little snippets of my life that I know are connected. I'll begin as a child. Nobody here knew me then. But I'll be honest, I was one of those kids who was really, really shy. Oral reports in school had to be avoided, if at all possible. In high school, even though I chose what we called the college prep track of classes, I avoided speech class. And it was required. So I don't know how I got away with it. But the fear of being singled out for me was very, very real. Sometime in my teen years, and looking back, I think it happened around 14 or 15, but I remember very well, I had this conversation with God. I was alone in the house. I was supposed to be doing housework. I had this conversation with God. Started out with talking, developed into screaming, crying, just sobbing. I was so upset. I needed something more than my family could provide. I was hungry for something bigger. I needed to know that I could affect the lives of a large number of people. Now, this is the kid who is so shy that she's not going to stand up in front of anybody and talk to them. So where did this desire come from? But I knew it was within me. It became my deepest desire. But at home, I was being groomed exclusively for the role of wife and mother, and these two tracks seemed miles apart. Totally exclusive. That's the way I saw them. The summer between my junior and senior years of high school, I had gotten my driver's license. 2 weeks later, I had a wreck, and it was my fault. The driver of the other car was taken to the emergency room, and I insisted upon going too. Even though I was not injured, I needed to wait and see if she was going to be all right. I waited and waited in the emergency room, and I learned what a hard job it is to be the one who sits and waits, and I felt so helpless. I wanted to help, and I saw all these people who worked there busy doing things, and I was just sitting waiting. Well, fast forward weeks or months later, during a senior English class, I was summoned to the office. That's not a good thing. I remember the day this happened. Because you had to get up out of your seat and walk in front of the class and go out the door. The one who does not want to be singled out for anything. Well, it happened that the guidance counselor wanted to talk to me. There was a rep from the local community college coming to the high school to talk with any students who might be interested in health science. Now, why would the guidance counselor think I might be interested in health sciences? I didn't even know I might be interested. I mean, I was in my fourth year of science, but there were a lot of kids. So I didn't know why she asked me. But I learned it was an opportunity. Well, if it meant getting out of class, I agreed to do it. So I met with the rep. And through him, I discovered I had an opportunity. Opportunity is a key word here. My parents had no money for an education, especially an education they deemed would be a waste of money for a girl. But I found if I worked hard, I might be able to afford a community college associate degree on my own. And I might be able to do it in 2 years. Now, I wanted to help people, so I was drawn to the fields of social work and nursing. My paternal grandmother had been a nurse in the early 1900s. She lived next door to us, and I spent a lot of time with her. And I loved listening to her nursing stories. Well, after high school, I enrolled in the Applied Sciences Nursing Program, completed my associate degree, took state boards, received my RN license, and it all happened before my 20th birthday. I look back on that and I think, 20? That is so incredibly young. Well, I quickly secured my first nursing job as an RN in a small hospital in the suburbs of Cleveland, Ohio. And then within a few months, the director of nursing approached me with an opportunity. The hospital would send me to Nashville for specialized continuing education classes in coronary care. This was the early 70s. Coronary care was a new specialty back then. I was 21. This opportunity was to prepare me to assume the position of a night shift charge nurse in the coronary care unit at the hospital. I said yes to the opportunity because I was finding work on a general med-surg floor was just not my thing. I was restless and dissatisfied. That made the opportunity very inviting. I discovered I loved working CCU. It meant working with just a few patients who had very acute needs. Now, as charge nurse, I learned, I was responsible for teaching in-service classes to hospital staff on how to function during what we called a code blue, crash cart emergency, you've seen it on TV. Now, just a few years ago, I was the shy teen who refused to take speech class. Now I had to teach these classes. But the door of opportunity was opening even wider. Well, one night during a CPR refresher, I met an emergency room orderly. We quickly became good friends and more. 4 months later, Chris and I decided to get married. And that was 45 years ago. And more opportunities ensued. We began moving frequently. Life was never boring, never dull. Lives of two children intertwined with our busy lives, living and loving, challenging and being challenged. More moves until we arrived in Indiana 30 years ago. I had taken 10 years off from nursing to focus on family. But once again, when we moved to Valpo, opportunity came knocking. It seems we had just settled into our house less than a mile from here, when an ad in the local paper said that a small residential hospice unit had opened at Whispering Pines, and they were still looking for a part-time RN. It just happened to be only 1 mile from our new home. Now, you need to know that a seed had been planted way back in the 70s. Early 70s when I was in college. I had learned about hospice care in England. I read a few books about it. It hadn't gotten a foothold in the United States yet, but it intrigued me. I was drawn to hospice theory at that time. And now here, The opportunity is on my doorstep. Well, I took the job, and the hours allowed Chris and I to manage our work schedules around the care of two young children. More opportunity was being presented. Working in hospice care, I found my faith was having more and more presence in my work. And it was about this time our family started attending worship here at First Christian. I felt my reawakening faith could grow here. However, I started reading a magazine that they would be put on a rack in the narthex. It was a magazine that used to be published by the Disciples of Christ. And I read letters to the editor. And I discovered the Christian church was struggling and divided about its response to homosexuality. I was confused. My strict Methodist upbringing told me to leave this church. But God had other plans, obviously. My hospice care of a young man dying of AIDS opened another door of opportunity, and I was invited to work for an AIDS service organization where I hired on as a nurse case manager. As clients, staff, and volunteers began sharing their life experiences with me, I struggled and I began feeling growing pains. Much of what I was learning about people challenged what I had been taught growing up. But because of my faith being reawakened during this time, I prayed for loving Christian understanding, that God would show me the truth through this struggle I was going through. Well, apparently I needed this experience, this struggle, for the next window of opportunity. And here's where you come in. In 2005, I felt God telling me to walk away from the AIDS case manager job. I'd been doing it for, I think, about 13 years. I had grown very close to some of my clients, seen a lot of people come and go. But I'd learned long ago that saying no to God is futile. So when God said it was time to leave, it was time to leave. I resigned. I was afraid by leaving that I would stop growing. It wasn't until after my resignation I felt God calling me to another opportunity into ministry here with you folks. Well, that's just kind of skipping through some highlights on my timeline, and it might seem pretty random. So let me weave it all together. You know what a tapestry is, right? It's a picture in fabric. It's formed by stitching together threads, and a picture forms. Well, way back in 1984, Chris and Sarah and I had an opportunity to go to Madrid. And while we were there, we visited an old tapestry factory and museum. And I learned tapestries are made and repaired from the back. You don't really see the picture. As artisans were working with needle and thread by hand from the back of the tapestry that's suspended on a big open frame, every so often they'd stop and they'd go around to the front to take a look at the picture. direction they're working. But they had to go around the front to see what they were doing. For me, that's an image that helps me see the story or the tapestry of my life. At 67, probably everybody here, we've got a collection of stories. Doesn't matter how old we are, we've got a collection of stories in our lives. But do we ever step away from it to look at the whole story? To look at the tapestry that is forming of our lives? I see each of these little stories as a combination of threads. Not separated the way I've described them. But these threads are connected to the other stories. The threads bind them together, weave them together. And looking through the eyes of faith, I can see within the tapestry of my life, there is a rich golden thread, a divine thread of God's presence that weaves in and out through each of the stories, and it links them all together. Throughout my life, God's been preparing me every step of the way for opportunities yet to come. And from the stories I chose to share with you, it may seem like it's just the good stuff, but that's not true. And I know this God thread is in the midst of the current stitches that are contributing to this tapestry of my life. I know the stitches today are part of the bigger picture. And not just my picture, my story. Our lives are interconnected. Here we all are here today. Our lives have interconnected. So we are in each other's tapestries. I think it's important that we share our certainty with others, that God is in the midst of it all of life. Even when bad things happen to us, even when we suffer the consequences for our own choices and our own mistakes. All those stories go into the making of our life tapestries, too. The good, the bad, and the ugly. We might not know today what God is doing, but we can believe God is here, still listening to the desires of our heart, and still opening doors of opportunity.
Is now our gracious host.
Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord.
To avoid many hands touching the same trays, we're not collecting offerings. Instead, if you're able to financially support the church, please drop an offering in the locked box on your way out. And as for communion, when you came in, you should have been given a sealed cup like this. Does anybody need one? Both elements are in here. The only trick is in opening it. First, you peel back a thin, transparent covering that will expose the wafer. You take the wafer out when time comes and you eat it. And then you take off the purple foil top, peel that off, and then you'll be able to drink the juice when the time comes.
Will you pray with me? Jesus sent his disciples ahead to prepare for the Passover meal. Lord, prepare our hearts and minds as we come to this meal that we may experience your extravagant love. Wash away all the doubts and confusion. Wash away all of our feelings of anger, hurt, and fear, that we may come to this table open and willing to love. Amen.
And we remember that last night on earth with his disciples before Jesus was arrested. During the meal, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and he blessed it and broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you." And after the meal, our Lord took a cup of wine and he passed it among them, saying, "Take and drink. This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sin. This is the blood of a new covenant." As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, remember me. Our Lord's table is open to all. It's time to get up. You need to stretch. Please stand if you're able, and together let's sing, "He Lives."
Salvation to impart. up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs for Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
May you be blessed with the assurance that it is God who has made you, God who has loved and redeemed you, and it is God who will sustain you always, offering you peace and hope in the midst of whatever this life brings your way. Amen.
Amen.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings, see glory.